Hello again. Today's last speech will be delivered by Özlem Aktürk, who came from Ege University, İzmir. But before moving on to that, I'd like to read her biography. Özlem Aktürk completes her high school education in İzmir and enrolls in American Culture and Literature Department in Istanbul University, which she left due to her personal dissatisfaction. Later on, she continues her education at the same department at Ege University. Her main concentration is media and film analysis. She is the founder and executive of the Film Club at the American Culture and Literature Department of Ege University. She will be attending a seminar on comparative film analysis at Bosporus University, and she also writes film analysis in some periodicals, such as Underground Poetics. Floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you. Good afternoon, my privileged guests. My name is Özlem Aktürk and I'm coming from Ege University. Firstly, I want to thank Bilkent University for organizing such an amazing event and accepting me here. It's an important opportunity for me to get to know you and make friends here. Hope you'll understand my excitement, and I hope you enjoy my presentation today, which is about the other within us, with a little psychoanalysis of the film Black Swan. How many of you have seen Black Swan? Because then I can skip the summary, plot summary. Should I continue with the plot summary? Okay, I'll continue. Black Swan, one of the best pictures of 2010, is an American psychological thriller directed by Darren Aronofsky and starring Natalie Portman, Vincent Cassel, and Mila Kunis. Its plot focuses on a theatrical adaptation of Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake Ballet by a prestigious New York City company. The new adaptation of the ballet requires a leading ballerina who should be able to play the pure and virtuous White Swan, as well as the last full Black Swan. One dancer, Nina, is a perfect fit for the White Swan, while Lily has a personality that matches the Black Swan. When the two compete for the parts, Nina finds a dark side to herself. The film is first and foremost a doppelganger story, which focuses on the other within us. Black Swan, in which the character Nina struggles to create her true self by becoming both the innocent White Swan as well as the seductive Black Swan, deals with a very up-to-date and humanitarian subject by using the doppelganger metaphor. Individuals suppress other side within due to the factors such as society, ethics, religion, and family. If we take the Hegelian dialectics, in which the oppositions make a synthesis as the basis, the definition of the other would be a part of what defines or even constitutes the self. The concept of otherness is also integral to the understanding of a person, as people construct roles for themselves in relation to an other as a part of a process of subjectivization or individualization. The idea of the other is regarded as constitutive into self-consciousness. We can say that the self requires the other to define itself, namely what he is, what he or she is and is not. Otherness may be considered as being different than the rest of the society, or the rest of your characteristics. In that sense, the other within us is the characteristics which we are expected to repress because of a demand for an approval in terms of society, religion, ethnicity, or familial relations. This repression creates dualism that sets our existence up as having a hidden nature. How many of you have thought about doing something but could not do it due to societal, religious, or familial constraints? In Black Swan, Nina, who is portrayed by Natalie Portman, is trapped between what her mother desires her to do, a familial constraint, and what her stage director Thomas expects from her. Nina is entitled as the Queen Swan in the adaptation of the Swan Lake Ballet. As she ascends in her dancing career, she starts to turn into the characters she plays. Nina has to be both the White Swan, the Queen of the Lake, and the Black Swan who seduces the prince at the same time. She has to be the innocent, pure, virgin, protected girl, a demand by her mother, and lustful, seductive, unpredictable, free and femme fatale woman, a demand by her employer. The duality of being both the White Swan and the Black Swan is the idealization of a dishonest perfection expected from a person both spiritually and physically in the capitalist society. reaching the perfection as being two opposite characters at the same time, yet none of them seems to care about what she really is or wants. How many of us actually live the life we want, or how much of our actions and desires consist of outer expectations? People now live in a world in which they have internalized the authority or the power of the society, of their family, or even of a lover. This internalization creates self-deception. It comes to a point that an individual or person defines himself through the social categorization of his or her formal identity. This essentially means that in being a waiter, student, or doctor, one believes that his or her social role is equivalent to his or her human existence. Living a life defined by one's occupation, social, racial, or economic class is the very essence of the self-deception, the condition in which people cannot go beyond their situations in order to realize what they must be, that is a human, and what they are not, that is not a doctor. In Black Swan, living with her mother, who is an ex-ballerina, Nina is a young girl who dedicates her life to ballet and dancing. There is no option such as quitting dancing. Nina seems to be unable to live without it. Even when the man at the club asks her who she is, she describes herself as being a dancer. The man asks, "You haven't told me who you are. I'm a dancer. No, I meant your name, oh Nina." She is deceived by the illusion that dancing is the essence of her true self, and it's the only way to exist in a competitive society. In densely populated, competitive, capitalist world, many relationships are created by people's attraction not to another person, but rather how that person makes them feel about themselves by how they look at them. This is a state of emotional alienation whereby a person avoids experiencing their subjectivity by identifying themselves with the look of the other. Thus, in living our lives, we often become unconscious actors. We become bourgeois, we become feminist, worker, party member, student, rocker, or Turkish. Each doing as we must fulfill our chosen characters' destinies. Here a new dimension arises in which the self becomes an object for others. A man or a woman will always be in a world of other people who can capture him or her within their gaze, reducing them to his external materiality. They will take his or her measure, call him hero, coward, genius, fool, naive, scarlet woman, or etc. Yet living life authentically or as you wish requires keeping out self-deception, living by the will of the self. It's the abolition of traditional ethics and morality. Being a moral person requires one to deny authentic impulses, everything that makes us human, and allow the will of another person to change one's action. Self-deception should not be at the heart of one's existence, since it is a tool of capitalism to control the masses. For example, keep off the grass sign, which derives its being from a capitalist need, but hinders the need of the masses for play and relaxation. This is just a simple example which you can multiply with what you keep seeing in your surroundings, such as don't smoke here, many do's and don'ts. Your world is suddenly haunted by the other's value, over which you have no control, and you are forced to kill the other within you. This process is continual and unavoidable. People are put in a very competitive situation, like a horse race in capitalist society, that they turn out to be too busy to discover themselves. All the outer expectations cause an inner conflict within us. People create alter egos or doppelgangers as an escape. One otherizes the repressed. Alterity is usually understood as the entity in contrast to which an identity is constructed, and it implies the ability to distinguish between self and not-self, and consequently to assume the existence of an alternative viewpoint. Additionally, German word Doppelgänger reveals an eerie theme which has been seen in numerous myths and folktales throughout the history. The protagonist of Der Doppelgänger, a prominent work of art composed by Franz Schubert, utters the time in which he encounters a stranger in the darkness of the night. Upon seeing his face, I am terrified. The moon shows me my own form. The literal translation of the word would be double goer in English. According to German myths and folk tales, doppelganger is the name for the spirit double or shadow of a person throughout one's life. Today in modern bourgeois or capitalist society that is set upon individualist philosophy, Doppelganger implies the ultimate nightmare, loss of subjectivity, of uniqueness, of self-conscious rationalist personality. In the historical context, it's not a coincidence that doppelganger has been used in literature via evil twin stories, such as William Wilson by Poe, The Double by Dostoevsky, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde by Stevenson, The Picture of Dorian Gray by Oscar Wilde. These are some of the examples which try to examine the modern age doppelganger, that is the struggle within every one of us, or the unconscious. Black Swan by Darren Aronofsky ought to be considered as one of the cinematic representations of this tradition. Nina's mother, Beth, and Lily are her alternates and herself. Nina suffers from the oppression that she should not like be her mother, that she should be like Lily, and Nina substitutes Beth. While creating an alternate for herself, Nina is supposed to comprehend that she is in fact the alternate itself. This is a journey for her in which she will find her true self. She has to search and find the black swan and everything that she represents in herself, not in the alternate. She has to carry both in her body. She has to struggle to eradicate the duality. Nina uses Lily as a tool of doppelganger so that she can explore her identity, womanhood and sexuality. It's obvious that all these negations provoke Nina to become the black swan. Gradually, the way Nina cannot distinguish herself from others focalizes on Lily, the other side of Nina, her evil twin or her gloomy counterfeit. Of course, this is a cinematic representation whereby the characters can have visible alter egos or doppelgangers. Yet think about it. Have you ever fantasized of being someone else, either in a moral or immoral way? Haven't you ever felt like you are trapped between what you really want and what others want from you? How many of undergrads study in the fields that they really want, and how many of them have chosen it due to outer expectations, such as freedom, such as from their family? It's obvious that people are forced to repress their incompatible sides deep down inside. What we repress may be just in order to fit in are the basic drives that makes us a human. As can be seen in Black Swan, Nina has to repress her unmatching characteristics due to the dominant mother figure. She seems to want to be a successful ballerina, though it is in fact not what she wants, but what her mother expects from her. As I mentioned before, this is a journey for Nina to find her true self. So consequently, Nina faces her evil twin and she reclaims the repressed as well as experiencing a metamorphosis. Mirror, you become alienated yourself. You see an other part of yourself, one in the mirror, the thesis, and one standing in front of it, the antithesis, creates your identity. This is the synthesis. Man is a creature haunted by a vision of completion. Human beings try to be perfect by reaching a completion. In the last part of the film, Nina delivers her performance in a perfect balance. At the end of this performance, which she achieves in spite of her mother and after killing Lily, Nina manages to get rid of Lily's ghost. Lily stands as another person in front of Nina. Her mother is not on the stage with Nina, but she sits in seat amongst the audience. To sum up, the way that Nina's personality is split into two as the symbols of black and white can be explained with the terms of Dionysus and Apollo by Nietzsche. White Swan corresponds with the Apollonian rational thought or pure life. Dionysian darkness and madness fit the archetype of femme fatale, the other side of Nina, the black swan, as shown in the club scene. Just as Nietzsche suggested, completeness, thus perfection, can only be reached by the combination or reunification of these binary oppositions or the others within us. When she carries all her binaries in equal distance, reclaims the repressed, and when the unconscious as well as the conscious, fantasy as well as reality, evil as well as good, letting go as well as control, happen to be in equilibrium, this means the completion and perfection. Man is always up after their object of desire. In this case, it's perfection. Reaching the perfection creates a pleasure, yet the subject constantly attempts to go beyond the limits of the prohibition imposed on his enjoyment, to go beyond the pleasure principle. Yet the result of transgressing the pleasure principle, according to Lacan, is not more pleasure but pain, since there is only a certain amount of pleasure that the subject can bear. Beyond this limit, pleasure becomes pain, and this painful principle is called jouissance. Thus, jouissance is suffering. Nina's perfect fall and death can be best explained by the concept of jouissance by Lacan. What lies beyond the principle of pleasure is the pain. Jouissance is the impossible and the death. In a competitive capitalist world where the authentic identity is lost, she keeps asking, mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the most perfect them all? Who doesn't? Thank you.
Thank you for this very interesting speech. If you have any comments, additions or questions, please feel free to participate. Yes,
because as we see in the movie, she lives in a very competitive world. She strives for getting the role and stuff. Thus, there is no option for her to create her true self. Maybe only in that she can find herself.
Thank you.
Just one comment on the ending of the film, because I've seen the movie and I was thinking that at the end, Nina could do nothing but just being a successful dancer as her mom asks her to be. So she only achieved what the society expected from her. So to my opinion, she was not successful in terms of finding her true self or something. Thank you.
Any other comments?
I have rather a long question. As we all know, finding one's character, finding the oneself, is one of the most important psychological problems of today's world. So, if we are not our occupation, the brand we wear, the book we read, as quoted in Fight Club, another movie concerning psychological inner struggles about finding self. So, what defines what we really are? Are we our desires? Are we does what gives us pleasure also define us? And one last question: is it possible to find the oneself, the real character within us in capitalist society? If not, what is needed for this? What is needed? What is required to find the real character that lies within ourselves?
Okay. In political terms, I am on the side of freedom, not on the side of order. Because order, as we see in like keep off the grass or don't smoke here or don't do this stuff, order. The government or the capitalist societies try to create order by limiting our freedom. And our freedom, I guess, comes from our desires. For example, you want to kill somebody, maybe this is an extreme example. You want to kill somebody, but you can't do it because you will be punished. And that's when your true self becomes trapped. And I don't think that it's possible in a capitalist society to find your true self because there are many constraints, as I mentioned, like familial, societal, religious, ethnicity, or governmental. What is required? The death of capitalism, I guess.
Right. That was inspiring. If we lose our order, if we lose our rules, all the rules in this world, don't you think we will fall into anarchy? And this primordial world, do you think will be really fun for us?
I don't remember which one said so, because I always mix them up, like Jean-Jacques Rousseau, John Locke, and the other one. Five or three of them.
Names are irrelevant, okay. Ideas are
irrelevant. One of them said that it's And he said it like 18 in the 17th century, I guess. But he said that it's not possible for us from now on that we turn our natural habitats, because people, the population is getting bigger and bigger, and as the population is getting bigger, your freedom is
declining,
because you shouldn't be, you know, restrain the others' freedom. So I guess from now on it's not possible that capitalism would be dead or, you know, extinguished.
We cannot know right now, can we?
Yeah, we cannot, but personally I am hopeless. I don't have any hope for, because I see people like mechanization. We see a waiter and we expect her. I mean, we know exactly what she will do. She will come near us, she will ask what we want, and then she will bring it. And we see a doctor or we see a student. Our borders are very exact now. And if you try to, if you try to get over your borders, then you will be judged by, you know, you will become the other in the society. Like, no, look at him, he is not obeying the rules, and he is gypsy, he is black, he is guilty, etc.
I understand you, but...
excuse me, please. Alright. I feel forced to prevent it from being the dialogue.
Okay, well, thank you for answering that.
Thank you.
Yeah, all about this concept of order and all this repressive barrier. I just wanted to come back to this process, like psychological process that Nina goes around the movie. In the end, she arrived in a certain state, like of maybe kind of freeing of herself, because actually she killed herself or something like this. We don't really know, actually. But I wanted to know if, in your opinion, she arrived to this state because she transgressed the rules, the like very strict rules represented by this ballet and by all this thing, or through this rules, thanks to this ballet, thanks to these strict rules, she managed to come to herself.
Not thanks to, but the other.
Like transgressing the rules of this ballet.
Yes. I mean, she's trapped between the disciplined and strict ruling atmosphere, like ballet atmosphere, because I don't think that it's a coincidence the director or the scriptwriter chooses the ballerina, because ballet both requires your bodily movement, you have control over your body, and it's very strict and disciplined sport or art form.
Yeah.
So it kind of represents capitalism, competitive atmosphere that we live even in our university.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I will spoil a little for the people that didn't see the movie, but in the very end, the Nina is looks satisfied. I mean, at least she expressed some kind of satisfaction.
Yes, she said it was perfect.
Yes, she said it was perfect. And she said it was perfect because she managed to go through all this process of order, all this process of very strict rules. So in a sense, she's also satisfied, in my opinion, by also having went through all this process, accepting it totally.
I mean, there is a fine line between being dead and being on the verge of being dead. I mean, for example, 3 seconds before you die, if you say it's perfect, maybe I don't think that she's enlightened at that moment. She's still deceived by what her mother or Thomas, her employer, wants from her. And she says that it was perfect because I did what you expect from me. But at the moment that she's dead now, no conscious, and that was the moment she's enlightened, I guess. And then the the curtain blacks out. She's dead, the curtain blacks out, and that's the perfection, in my opinion.
Thank you.
And I just want to add just one more point. Like, I think that human psychology is more complex than this. Like, even there is no capitalism or something, there is no one human self. Like, we are so complex that we don't have one self, so I don't know, if not all capitalism to blame. We are just, human psychology is so complex.
Okay, I respect your opinion, your comment. But before capitalism, for example, I don't think that human psychology is simple. So it's both evolving and it's complex. We have both the virtuous or white or virgin Mary-like characters, namely the females, and also the femme fatale, seductive, and etc. But take Turkey as an example. If you wear miniskirts and if you kiss a boy on the streets, it's so easy for someone else to blame you as being bitch. But maybe you are not bitch then, or maybe you are bitch and or at the same time you are also virtuous maybe. But the people in capitalist society are so eager to give titles to you. Like, if she does this, she is this. If she does this, she is this. They draw a border between the good and the bad. That's why human psychology is not so simple. We are not just black or we are not just white. We have, like yin and yang, we have the both sides.
Yes, but we live with people. Being a human is to live with people, the other people around us. It is impossible not to be influenced by another person.
That's why I said I am against order, I am for freedom. That's why it's my personal opinion, of course I respect you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just to
see
some people
maybe after they share their opinion you may continue.
Because it wasn't the subject.
Yes, but I mean
first of all I want to thank you for your subject that you want to focus on the other in ourselves. It is also my topic. And I, like Yasemin, I don't think that the blame it is totally on the capitalist society. Actually, you may argue that it can be on the society, but capitalism or the political situation is not a big matter in this thing. And I want to, was it Etienne's question or Errol Jones, I can't remember now, but he said if this suppression helped Nina to find her devil self in herself or not, and you said you do not think so, but this suppression and stress and control on you and your childhood are all effects that result in split personality. And if you want to hear more, I will talk tomorrow. Thank you.
I mean, I'm not trying to impose what I think, or I'm not trying to convince you, like, I believe this and you should believe this.
And yes, I like that these are all our opinions.
I like your comments, because,
I mean, there are, like, 5 billion people in the world. We may have 5 billion opinions in the world, so we do not have to agree with each other. But these are facts.
You say you were against rules and you're against capitalism, but which one do you call capitalism? Our rulers today, or the conventional killings and the our conventional culture and those behaviors that result from these commercial cultures. Because if you call our rulers capitalists, then you're against that.
No, I don't do it. Because capitalism is not something political, it's something economical.
But you're against rules.
Yes.
And you're for the people, for freedom of people.
I'm against capitalism and I'm against rules.
When there are no rules, then in Turkey there would be more killings because of our conventions.
You know my graduation thesis on serial killing, serial murders in America. I wrote my thesis, graduation thesis, and in that thesis, what I argue is that serial killing or violence is the side effect of the capitalist society. Of course, before capitalist society, there were murders also, but now people, for example, again take a man, like suits up and goes to his closed office works, like he works 9 to 5 and then comes back home and stuff. But it's not in our nature. We are human, but we are also animal. So we belong to nature. But if you try to trap us in some, you know, closed places like offices, and if you force a boy or a man to go always to the same place, to the closed place and stuff, then he should some kind of react to it. Sometimes it's, I don't support it or I don't say that it's okay, but sometimes the violence comes out of it as a reaction to capitalist constraints, I guess. But capitalism, I don't mean government, I mean the modes of production like economics, like globalization, like IKEA-ization.
And also, you call the ballet, Nina's being a ballerina, the essence
of her true self.
No, a symbol of capitalist government. But as much as I remember, the director of the show where Nina will play doesn't want her to be strict and doesn't want her to be strict at all, and he just wants her to be free, and he doesn't want her to be disciplined at all. Can you comment on that?
For example, we are under a republic, democratic republic, but democratism, democracy and republicanism changes from one governmental ruler to the other. I mean, one is more relaxed and the other one is more, I mean, strict maybe. But the main concepts of this government or the ballet discipline does not change so often. I mean, of course he can say that, oh, you should be more relaxed, but there are some basic rules in the art of ballet she should do. And also that's where her duality or her repression becomes, because her mother wants her to be so strict, and her employer, the outside society, wants her to be more loose. Then she's confused, she becomes confused, and she asks herself, what should I be, what should I want, what I really want, and that's where her tragedy begins, I guess.
Thank you.
Next, to my friends, Ayda, you said you were on the side of order rather than freedom, and you gave the extreme examples of killing one person and smoking wherever they want, one person wants. But don't you think killing one person was
an extension of his freedom?
Yes, but do you think killing one person is, I don't know, it shouldn't be like that, because killing that person would be the prevention of that person, the freedom of that person to live, I think, and the prevention in the smoking example, if one person smokes in an area, it would prevent others' freedom of living in a healthy area, I think. Don't you think that rather than demolishing order there should be a balance between freedom and order, and that there should be order to for the realization of everybody's freedom.
Firstly, I want to say that our subject is otherness today. And as we take us as a society, the killer, the murderer, becomes the other for us, right? Because we can't, we haven't killed anybody, and we don't want it. But I think we should empathize, try to empathize with him a little bit. You know the castration stuff going on today? I don't agree with them, because firstly you have to go deep down inside him. Why he is like this? Why I'm not like this, but he is like this? What made him, what turned him like a, you know, a monster or a killer and stuff? But order just gives orders. Like they say, I mean, castrate him or put him in a jail and stuff. But I think we should a little bit try to empathize with what we call as others, like killer or murder. Of course, it's not what I'm supporting, but we try to understand why are they like this, because we can't give a guarantee that our child would turn out to be like this in the future.
Thank you. I just want to say it will be a funny example of question. Take the example of Tarzan. Everybody knows Tarzan, I mean. So if a person lives away from society and capitalism and in a jungle, do you think Tarzan finds himself? I mean, is it possible? He influences from animals again. Like, free. What is freedom here? Free minds, free psychology.
Freedom begins, I guess, in psychological and personal, like your individualist terms, where you aren't influenced by what other things. Like you dress like this today, I dress like this today. Just think about it. How many percentage of it, like you think, what people think about me, will they find me beautiful and stuff? But if you live in on a desert island, would you have any thoughts like this?
Other thoughts, like I will take the examples of animals probably, I will put a tail on me. And
yes, and if I were living in a jungle, probably, and if I was to do this presentation, then I would be criticizing the jungle society.
The thing you talk about is utopia and it is impossible to reach.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, one last question. I think we have to stop. This discussion seems to be endless. And
actually, it is more like an answer for this Tarzan example. I was just going to say that Tarzan is the definition of the other again by capitalism. So we cannot say that real freedom will be like the Tarzan's freedom or Tarzan's lifestyle.
So, and he is also produced by capitalism.
Yes, I think capitalism again dictates the fact that, the fact taught by capitalism again, that you will be like this if you will be free, so don't be free, I think.
Thank you.
I will kindly ask you to continue the discussion outside, because people are leaving, I think. Time we stop.
But I want to thank you very much for your comments and your questions.